this morning. You know, we can trust the Lord because the truth is, He says in His Word, when we seek Him, we'll find Him. When we call to Him, He answers. How many of you have ever sought the Lord? You've chased the Lord. You've looked for the Lord. And He answered you. He heard you. And He answered you. It's easy to trust somebody when they've proven themselves time and time and time again. And this is what I tell the Lord now. I say, you know what, God? You have nothing left to prove to me. You have proved yourself faithful time and time again. We serve a good God. We serve a good God, church. Come on, let's give Him a big praise this morning. Thank you, Lord, that when we seek You, we find You. Thank You that when we call on the name of Jesus, it doesn't fall on deaf ears. You are a powerful, awesome God, and You answer the call, Father God. We love You so much. And Lord, we want to be faithful back. We want to answer when You call on us to do something. We want to answer with faithfulness, Father God. We love You so much. We want You to have Your way in this service, Holy Spirit. Have Your way in this service. We love You so much, Jesus. We welcome You into this place. Thank You for Your faithfulness. Thank You for Your presence, Lord. Thank You that You're in the house right now. Thank You that everything changes for the better because You are here. You are here, Lord, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Can you give Him a praise in the house this morning? Give Him a big praise in the house this morning. He is worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy of our praise. No matter what you're going through, He's still worthy of our praise. He's still faithful. No matter what you're facing, He's still worthy of our praise. He's still faithful. No matter how hard it looks, He's still worthy of our praise. He's still faithful. It doesn't matter the circumstance. It doesn't matter the trial. It doesn't matter the lie that the enemy is telling you. God is still faithful. He is still faithful. Listen, church, that's why we were able to go to a celebration of life yesterday and see people celebrating the faithfulness of God. Celebrating the goodness of God in the midst of pain and sorrow and sadness. The heavier side of the pendulum was praise and thanksgiving. I want y'all to be keeping Christine Garza and her family in prayer, the Garcia family, the extended family and friends. As her daddy has gone on to, her earthly father has gone on to be with the Lord in heaven. Would y'all keep them, keep our family in your prayers? But be encouraged, because I'll tell you what, her dad left a great legacy for his family, for his children and his children's children. And they're going to be okay. They're going to be all right. That's why they can be here worshiping today. Because when you know who you serve and His faithfulness, man, you can't help but worship Him with all you've got. God is faithful. He is good. And we can worship Him no matter what. It makes so much a difference when you know that your loved one lived a life pleasing to God, left you more than nuggets, left you a whole boatload of, the baton has been passed, and He's left you all the goods for you to keep on keeping on in the faith with God. And so I know that this family is going to keep doing that, but we're going to keep them in our prayers. The enemy will come and try to tell lies, but we're going to combat it with the truth of God's word. We're going to remember that God is good and He is faithful. Give the Lord a big praise in the house this morning. Can y'all give it up for our worship team? They are amazing. They are amazing. I always move back. Thank y'all so much. Oh, they're amazingly fast, too. They done said, see ya. Wouldn't want to be ya. Just for that, I ought to call it back over here. We'll keep worshiping, though. She's like, we're still right here. Look what the Lord has done. Come on. Look what the Lord has done. Come on. He
healed my body, he touched my mind, he saved me just in time. Oh, I'm gonna praise his name.
I started y'all real low.
Each day is just the same.
1, 2, 3, 4.
I'm gonna praise him.
Look what the Lord has. Sing that song. We remind ourselves. We have to tell ourselves. We have to remind ourselves, look what the Lord has done. We have so much to be grateful for, y'all. So much. So much. That's why we can say, look what the Lord has done. I said, that's why we can say,
look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done.
What did he do?
He healed my body. He touched my mind. Just in time, oh, I'm gonna praise his name.
Woo!
Each day is just the same.
Yes!
Come on and praise him.
Look what the Lord has done. Yes! Come on, give him a big praise! Listen, last night, boom! Yes, y'all are so anointed. My goodness. Praise the Lord. Last night at the Celebration of Life, they took off singing little choruses. They're called coritos, which means little choruses, I think. I don't know. What do I know? Yo no sé. Is it? Is that what it means? She said that's what it means. Okay, see? Man, I'm so smart because of you, Jesus. Yeah, so they're little choruses. So they said, we're going to sing this. And so what it is they sing one little chorus, and then it goes to another little chorus, another. They're all different. But they just keep going and going and going. And do you know, don't ask me how I knew every song but one. Isn't that crazy? But my grandpa was a preacher, and they used to do that. And you go from this one to that one to that one to that one to that one, to do Lord or do Lord. And then you go to the next one and the next one, and you just keep going. And it sticks. So teach your kids God's word. Teach your kids all these songs. It sticks. I was so blessed. Christine was telling me, and this is just, again, just to let y'all know the power of when we sell out to Jesus, and we're going to get to the word in just a second. The power of when we sell out to Jesus is amazing. It's amazing what one life can do. How many people one life can touch and change. And I heard about her daddy touching so many lives. In the midst of whatever, even when he was hurting, he was ministering to other people, wherever God put him. You know, what a blessing, one life. But she was sharing with me, and I was such a neat thing to find out. She was saying, and before her daddy died, passed away, just recently, she just told me that her daddy had just told her he was remembering things, you know, and just reminiscing on the goodness of God. And she said he was talking about my grandfather and saying that my grandfather was his mentor. I never knew that. Isn't that amazing? But look, my grandpa poured into him, but then your dad took that and he poured and just kept going. And now he's poured into his children, right? And they're pouring. Give the Lord a big hand. Look what the Lord has done. We could just talk all morning about stuff like that. There's so many testimonies in this room. Y'all give it up one more time. I better get to the word. Y'all give it up one more time for our worship team. Let them know how grateful you are that they're doing their part here in the house. Amen. You may be seated. We want to welcome you again. We're so glad that you're here. Thank you for your prayers. It's so good to be in the house. We were out last week, not because we wanted to be, that's for sure. But we're so grateful that Chris and Tisa stepped in. And didn't they do an amazing job? Yes. That teamwork makes the dream work, right? They did so good. Can y'all give them one more hand? Show some love. Just love to see what God is doing in their life. So we're so grateful to be in the house. Thank you for your prayers. They work. As y'all can see, I'm whole and healed in the name of Jesus. Nothing missing, nothing broken. I told when the elders came to pray with us before we came in here this morning, I said, yeah, we're whole and healed. Don't let looks, I said, looks can be deceiving. Looks can be deceiving because pastor's got the thing on his leg and blah. All we know is there ain't nothing wrong with this, right, honey? The devil is a liar. So we trust Jesus. We know he's good. He's faithful. But we're so glad to be here this morning. I want to welcome everybody again. Those of you who've joined us online, just sit tight and be ready because God has a word for us this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that your presence is here. We don't want to do anything without you, Jesus. We can't do anything without you. Apart from you, we can do nothing. Apart from you, we are nothing. But thank you that we can do all things through you, Christ, who infuses us with inner strength. Thank you, Father God, that you right now are going to speak to your people, Father God. Thank you, Lord, that you're going to speak to those who don't know you and that today they will come into a relationship with you, Jesus. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for the power that's in your word. Thank you that as we hear your word and heed to it, Father God, we can't leave the same. We leave this place better than when we walked in. We leave, if those tuning in online, leave listening, tuning in online, better than when they tuned in, Father God. Thank you for your faithfulness. We love you so much. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, and we say, have your way. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Okay, so I did bring these up here. I'm going to put these on. Y'all just forgive me for a second. Let me put these things on. Wear these all the time. Can y'all please turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 133. Psalm 133. We're going to start with verse 1. We're going to read the first few verses. It says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Everybody say unity. It's like the precious oil upon the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the edges of his garments. It is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore. I want you to say, for there. Say it again, for there. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, life forevermore. We've been in this series, I Love My Church. How many of you love your church? It's been a great series. Yes, me too. It's been a great series. And like I said last week, we got to hear from Brother Chris and from his beautiful wife, Tisa. And I think they did a great job as they shared some of their experiences, parts of their testimony, and why they love their church. And so today, I have the honor of closing out this series. As I share God's word with you this morning, I want to say again, I love my church. I love the church, period. The church. How many of you know Christ died for the church? So I'm going to love what he loves, okay? But I love my church. I love that God has allowed me to be a part of this body and that he has entrusted Pastor Paul and I with the plans that he has for us. And so I want you to know this morning, I want you to realize what the church is and how important the church is. I want you to realize just how important the church is. The church is not just a gathering of people, a gathering of people that just do a few songs, meet for a couple of hours, say a prayer or two, read a couple of scriptures, and then we just go home and nothing changes. It's not just something, a meeting that pastors came up with because they didn't have nothing to do. They were a little bored, so they came up with, you know, church on a Sunday morning. It's not just us getting together and leaving with no change happening. The church was birthed by God for a reason. I said the church was birthed by God for a reason. It's an entity. It's an institution. It's an organization that's here for a purpose. This morning, I believe that I have a great word for you, for us, from the Lord, a mighty word in due season. And so this morning, I'd like to share on the subject, it's all in the swing.
The Duke and Ella. So let's have a wonderful.
Don't mean a thing if it ain't got- It don't mean a thing. All you gotta do is sing. Do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a. Makes no difference if it's sweet or high.
That's right.
Give that rhythm everything you got.
But
oh, don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. Do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Don't mean a thing. All you gotta do is sing. Do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a-do-a.
It don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. Come on. So what I want you to know this morning is that it's all in the swing. Because it don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing. It's going to make a little more sense as we go along, okay? I want you to be listening this morning for four truths that I want to share this morning. Be listening for them. I may say number one, I may not. I didn't have points and then somehow points came out. But listen, I want you to be listening for four truths that I want to get across this morning, that I believe the Lord wants to get across to his church this morning, that I believe is going to help propel Rescue Church to a whole nother level. How many of you would like to see Rescue Church go to a whole nother level? How many of you would like to see Rescue Church do some mighty things for the Lord? How many of you would like to see Rescue Church go beyond where we've gone? Go where no man has gone before. Oh, wait, that's Star Trek. Listen, we're all clapping and we're saying yes, so you know what that means, right? That means that you have to go to a whole nother level. That you have to do some mighty things for the Lord, because the church isn't the building. The church is us, the people, right? And so if we want Rescue Church to go to a whole nother level, that means we're saying, I want to go to a whole nother level. You heard them, Lord. They were clapping and saying yes and amen to that. And so this morning, have that in mind as we're talking about these four truths that I believe the Lord wants to get across to us. How many of you know that in the United States, there are embassies? Well, not just, I said in the United States. How many of you know that the United States has embassies, let me say that right, all over the world? Nobody knows? Nope. Do y'all know what an embassy is? Well, let's just go there. An embassy is a group of people who represent their country in a foreign country. Okay? The building where they meet is also called an embassy. An embassy is a group of people appointed to undertake a mission or take part in a formal process on behalf of a larger group. An embassy is a body of diplomatic representatives. An embassy's purpose, if we're going by these definitions that I just gave you, an embassy's purpose is to represent a country's government, one country's government, in another country. And inside the embassy, you'll find what are called ambassadors. And here's what you need to know about ambassadors. Ambassadors are loyal to the country they represent, even though they live in a foreign land. Ambassadors, I'm going to say that again, are loyal to the country they represent, even though they live in a foreign land. Something else you need to know about ambassadors. Ambassadors represent the interests and values of their king, or their president, or their country in a foreign land. Ambassadors participate in society in the foreign land that they live in, but they're not citizens of that foreign land. One last thing that you need to know about an embassy this morning is that when an embassy is attacked, it is considered an attack on the nation they represent. I want you to keep all these things in mind. Why am I sharing this? I'm sharing this because of this. You can call it number one if you want. This is the first truth I want you to get. We are ambassadors for Jesus Christ. Yes, we are ambassadors for Jesus Christ. You can clap to that. Come on. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 5. We're going to look at verses 17 through 21. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 21. It says when someone becomes a Christian, he becomes a brand new person inside. He is not the same anymore. A new life has begun. Listen, when we say yes to relationship with Jesus, that's not like, okay, I finally, okay, I got to that point. I gave my life to the Lord. I'm done. No, it says right here, it's the beginning of a new life. A new life has just begun. And when we come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, when we say yes to relationship with Jesus, when we become a Christ follower, a Christian, we become a brand new person. And the word says we're not the same anymore. We're not the same person that we were. Verse 18. All these new things are from God, who brought us back to himself through what Christ Jesus did. And God has given us the privilege of urging everyone to come into his favor and be reconciled to him. For God was in Christ, restoring the world to himself, no longer counting men's sins against them, but blotting them out. This is the wonderful message he has given us to tell others. And here's verse 20. We are Christ's ambassadors. God is using us to speak to you. We beg you as though Christ himself were pleading with you. Receive the love he offers you. Be reconciled to God. For God took the sinless Christ and poured into him our sins. Then in exchange, he poured God's goodness into us. We're Christ's ambassadors. And he wants us to represent him. And he wants us to let people know about the good news. The thing that got us saved, right? The good news about Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross, what he did through the cross, burial, and resurrection. I mean, sometimes we try to tell God, you do this for me, I'll do this for you. But listen, there's no bartering with him. Y'all know when we barter, it's like it's an even trade. I'm going to give you something and you're going to give me something of equal value, right? There is no comparison to what the Lord did for us. We can never repay him. He gave us his righteousness, and he took upon himself our sins. That's not a fair exchange, right? But we are so grateful that he did it. We are so grateful that he did it. Verse 17 says, when someone becomes a Christian, he becomes a brand new person inside. He's not the same anymore. A new life has begun. As one person put it, in this quote, we are not reformed, rehabilitated, or re-educated. We are recreated. We're recreated. And the reason he does that is for a purpose. It's for a purpose. It's not just to get saved and I'm done. There's a purpose behind it. And the purpose is in verse 20, to be Christ's ambassadors, right? God wants to use us. He wants to use us to plead his case. He wants to use us to demonstrate God to the world. In this verse, Paul compares the church to an embassy with Christians as ambassadors representing what? The kingdom of God. Paul says that we are Christ's ambassadors, so that means the church, you and I, are a group of people who represent our country, which is heaven, because remember, we are not of this world. If you read your Bible, it says we're not citizens of here. We're not of this world. We're aliens here. We're citizens of heaven. And so God, this scripture is saying us, the church, we're a group of people that are here to represent our country, heaven, in this foreign land that we're in called earth. Amen. Our role as the church is to represent the kingdom of God. And it's to make disciples as we're doing that. Amen. But listen, I want you to know this morning that we can't do that if we don't have a personal, vibrant, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. I said, we can't do that if we don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You know why? Because we can't represent someone we don't know. If we're called, according to this verse 20, to be ambassadors for Christ, but we don't know the one that we're supposed to be representing, how is that possible? It's not. It's not. So we have to know who we're representing. And we know that by coming to this place and hearing God's word and then leaving this place and having a personal relationship with Jesus and still hearing God's word. We do that by getting in his word, by getting in his presence, by getting in praise. we can't represent somebody we don't know. The second truth that I want you to know is this, it's number two, that it's time to grow up. I believe that Christ is telling us, Rescue Church, it's time to grow up. It's time to grow up. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to look at verse 15 and 16. And I'm reading it out of the Message. It's just so plain. It's very easy to understand. And here's what it says. No prolonged infancies among us, please. We'll not tolerate babes in the woods, small children who are easy prey for predators. God wants us to grow up, to know the whole truth and tell it in love. Like Christ in everything, we take our lead from Christ, who is the source of everything we do. Who's the source of everything we do? Christ. Say it with me. Who's the source of everything we do? Christ. Jesus is the source of everything we do. It goes on to say, He keeps us in step with each other. His very breath and blood flow through us, nourishing us so that we will grow up healthy in God, robust in love. Do you know that spiritual maturity is the biggest thing lacking in the church? Not just Rescue Church, but the church worldwide. I'm going to say that again. Spiritual maturity is the biggest thing that's lacking in the church. We need to get in the Word. And then when we get in the Word, we need to practice the Word. We need to be in church. But when we hear the Word, then we need to go out there and do what the Word is saying for us to do. We need to pray. You need to praise. Listen, sometimes we pat ourselves on the back, and I was sharing this with somebody yesterday. Sometimes we get so excited, and we should, that you know what? Okay, I'm finally, you know, I read a couple of chapters today. But it's not about doing it once in a while, right? It's consistency that matters. By the way, that was my word for the year that the Lord gave me. He told me consistency was my word for the year. I didn't like the word when He told me. But He's so smart. He knows what He needs to tell us, right? I was looking for this wonderful word, and it was like consistency. But He kept telling me over and over again. My honey went up to my office. I was up in my office studying or doing something, and he came up, and then he said, blah, 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 consistency. And I was like, excuse me. I got to say, I'm sorry. Lord, I'm sorry. Okay. But I had like to deliver. He's like, what are you doing? I said, I just have to talk to the Lord because I did not want that word. I wanted, I don't know. Some people say a sexy word. I don't know what you call it. I'm an exciting word. Consistency sound like work. Come on. But the Lord knows what we need. Okay. So listen. So we get excited because, okay, yeah, I'm doing this. I'm spending time. Look, God, like, you ought to be happy, Lord. At least I did this. Can I tell you something? We are not doing God a favor when we spend time in the Word. We are not doing God a favor when we get in the Scriptures. We're not doing God a favor when we do it. Well, I lifted my hands in church today. Well, praise the Lord, you should. But you know what? We're not doing God a favor. God knows the Word. He is the Word. We're doing ourselves a favor when we get in the Word. The Word is for our benefit, not His. He is the Word. When we get in the Word, we're not doing God a favor. We're doing ourselves a favor because we're renewing our mind, the Bible says, by the power of His Word. We're changing our thinking. We're getting in a right mindset. We're getting the mind of Christ on the matters of life. And now we can enjoy the fruit of it. We can enjoy, we're going to reap the benefits of getting into the Word of God, of doing things God's way. So we don't do Him a favor. We do ourselves a favor when we get in the Word. And when we do that, we're going to grow. We're going to grow into mature people. I'm going to tell you, as a hygienist, y'all know I said this before, I my patients, just one of the things they just did not want to do, they just hated flossing. They don't want to floss. Maybe you're in here and you don't want to floss either. Don't raise your hand. But listen, I'm like, I used to say, you gotta floss. You gotta floss. You gotta floss. You gotta floss. It wasn't working. They weren't doing it. I'm telling them. They're here now. I know. And they even said, I know. I know. I gotta floss. And then they'd go. And then 6 months later, 3 months later, for some of them. I had one patient that came 1 month later. I saw them every month. They said, I'd rather come see you once a month than floss. I was just crazy. But anyway, they would come back and I'd ask the question, which I didn't really have to ask because all my tests showed they weren't doing it. But, you know, I gave them a chance to fess up and make the correction. But I said, have you been flossing? like, oh, no, I know I need to, but no, nothing changed. They wouldn't do it. And so I quit saying, you got to floss. You have to floss. I quit saying that because it was doing no good. So you know what I started saying? I said, I never forget the first patient I said this to. It was a gentleman, and I said, oh, he goes, I hate floss. I said, well, you don't have to floss all your teeth. And he goes, well, you didn't say that. He goes, well, which ones do I have to floss? I said, just the ones you want to keep. He was so mad at me. Like, he was for real mad at me. He got over it, but he was really mad at me. And I was like, well, I mean, it's the truth. So I'm here to tell you this morning, you don't have to read your Bible. You don't have to read your Bible to be a Christian. I mean, if you're a Christian, I would think you would want to read your Bible. But you don't have to. So I'm not going to tell you this morning, you have to. In fact, I had put it in my notes. You have to read your Bible. And I took it off. I put a line through it because the truth is you don't have to read your Bible. You can just keep thinking the way you think, keep doing things your way, and keep wondering why it's not working. God gave us His word for our benefit. I love the way somebody, I don't know who it was that said this. I hope I wrote it down. Maybe I did. I hope so. Let me see. Somebody said this. You don't have to read the Bible. Just spend all day doing dumb stuff and getting in trouble. Somebody else said this. God gave us His word so that we wouldn't go around doing stupid. That's why we have His word. But we don't have to read it. And even if we read it, we don't have to do what it says. We really don't. You don't have to spend time with God. You don't have to spend time in praise and worship. You don't have to spend time in prayer. Don't talk to God. Don't listen to God. But know that you're going to reap the rewards of those actions that you're doing. Really, we have the freedom of choice. You don't have to put gas in your car. But eventually, you're not going anywhere. You don't have to clean your house, ladies. Yay! I don't have to clean my house. Look at your husband and say, hey, she said I don't have to clean my house. You don't have to clean your house. You can live like a little pig, like a little oinker. It can be really stinky in there, really messy in there. You don't have to wash your clothes. Eventually, you will have nothing to wear. But you don't. What I'm trying to get across this morning is, church, we don't have to spend time in God's word. We don't have to spend time in prayer. We don't have to spend time in His listening to God. We don't have to spend time coming here and hearing the word. We don't have to be connected to the church. But there's going to be consequences to not doing those things. And we can't blame God, and we can't blame the church, and we can't blame anybody else for what's going on in our lives, because the Bible says that we have been given the power of choice. The Lord says, I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Then He gave us the answer in case we were too slow to know what to choose. He says, choose life. Choose life. God wants to He wants to change us. He wants to transform us, and He wants to transfer us from being consumers to contributors. He wants to change us from just being people that come to get blessings to be people that want to be a blessing. Come on, that's what He wants to do in Rescue Church. He wants us to not be always the ones that are coming to church to see what we can receive, to see what we can get, but that we're coming to church to see what we can give, to see how we can help heal the body of Christ. He wants us to be contributors, not just consumers. I believe that's what the Lord is saying to Rescue Church this morning. It's time to grow up. It's time to grow up. And the way that we grow up is not just when we come one time a week and spend a couple hours in church, though that is so important, but it's what we do when we leave here as well. It's that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. It's our personal relationship with Him outside of the crowd when nobody's watching that counts. Someone said this, you just can't come to church and always get splash over blessings of somebody else's walk, of somebody else's prayer life, of somebody else's praise. I think pastors mentioned that before. Sometimes you come and yes, you can get that from His walk, from His prayer life, but it's got to go beyond that. If we're going to be those people that we said we want to be, if we want Rescue Church to go to a whole nother level, if we want to do mighty exploits for the kingdom, if we want to be change agents in this world, if we want to make a difference, then it's going to take us growing up. Tell the person next to you, it's time to grow up. It's time to grow up. That means doing the right thing when we don't feel like it. That means doing the right thing just because it's the right thing to do. That means doing what's right when we want to do what's wrong. When we, every time that we want to choose wrong, that we want to do wrong, but we choose right, we do right, we grow in God. Every time we make a right choice, we grow in God. We can't come to church year after year and never change. If your life is the same as it was last year, something's wrong. We need Christians who have become disciples, who then in turn can disciple other people. A disciple is a learner. A disciple of Christ. A disciple is a follower of Christ. We follow in his ways. We follow in his footsteps. So we don't just want to be Christians. We want to be Christ followers, disciples. We want to be disciples, followers of Jesus. We want to be people who not just get ministered to, but eventually we're ministering to others. We want to be people who get our minds off of ourselves long enough to think about somebody else. You know, when somebody's complaining a lot to me, and they're telling me they're bored, and they're telling me all these negative things, and they're whining, basically, I'm like, we need to find you something to do. We need to find you somebody to serve. When we're just, our mind is just on ourselves, it causes problems. God wants us to grow up. Tell the person next to you, it's time to grow up. You know, we have so much available to us, but we have to grow up to get it. God's not going to trust us with more if we can't handle what we have right now. He says, show me you can be faithful in the little so I can give you the much. It's time to grow up. It's time to grow up. Chris and Tisa were talking about giving, and I know it steps on people's toes, and I know people get upset when you talk about money in church, and I don't get it. You ought to be happy when we talk about money in church, because you don't want that thing holding you hostage, keeping you in bondage. God gives us his word to free us up to enjoy this life. I want the church to know. I want Rescue Church to know. I want you to know. Everyone who's listening, even online, I want you to know. It's not just about getting saved and going to heaven. Though that is a huge deal. That's eternal, right? God also wants us to enjoy this life right here, right now. He says, I came that you might have life and enjoy it to the fullest till it overflows, till it gets off on other people. Come on. The Bible says that the enemy came to kill, steal, and destroy. He wants to kill us, literally take us out. He wants to steal our peace, steal our joy. But the Lord says, I came that you might have life and life to the fullest, life in abundance, till it overflows, till it gets off on other people. So it's not just, I don't want you to just get to heaven. I want you to enjoy heaven on earth. Come on. Are you listening to me this morning? We have a lot available to us. There's a lot of promises in this word. But some of them, we're just going to get them when we grow up. We're going to get them when we have a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, because there's principles in this word that we have to walk out. Don't ask me to pray for your finances if you're not tithing. I said, don't ask me to pray for your finances if you're not tithing. It's like, God's like this. Rope. This is a rope. You're wanting him to bless your finances. He's like, I'm telling you how to get your finances blessed. This is how you do it. This is how you do it. This is how you do it. We have to do things God's way. There's a lot available to us, but we have to grow to get it. And how do we do that? By letting God have all of us, by giving him all of us, letting him have his way in our lives. Here's the third truth I want you to get this morning, Rescue Church. We need to stay connected to church. I said, we need to stay connected to church. Hebrews 10, 24 through 25 says, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Listen, when Sunday feels like any other day, something's wrong. I said, when Sunday feels like any other day, something's wrong. That's a red flag. Hey, that's a red flag in relationships. That's a red flag in your relationship with Jesus Christ. When Sunday is just another day. Sunday is not just another day. Sunday is the day that we have set aside for the Lord. So that when somebody comes and says, hey, you want to go fishing Sunday? You're like, what do you say? What do y'all say? I'm going to church. I'm going to church. The church is a military unit. I said the church is a military unit, and it's under constant attack by the enemy. And that's why the author of Hebrews told us that we need to stay connected here. I said we need to stay connected here. In the same way Paul tells us that part of what we do as a church is that we keep watch over one another. We restore each other. When one of us falls into sin, we restore each other. We bear one another's burdens. We bear one another's sorrows. We see that we encourage each other. We did that yesterday as we went and showed our love and support for the Garza and Garcia family. We pray for one another. We confess things to one another. In other words, we hold each other accountable. Come on. We watch out for one another. We tell each other, come on. We help each other press on and not quit and not give up. And a huge part of how we do this is by staying committed to the local church, by staying connected to the local church. You know, membership is in the Bible. Did you know that? We're fixing to have a membership coming up. Membership is in the Bibles. You know why I say that? Because he says that we're one body and many members, and that we need each other, and that we can't say I'm more valuable than you. We all need each other. And listen, what good is my foot if it's not attached to my body, if it's not connected? We have to stay connected to the church. We have to stay connected to the church. I want you to look at the person next to you and say, we need to stay connected to church. We need to stay connected to church. My foot can't do anything if it's not attached to the body. Every believer needs to be committed to the local church. There are things that God's going to tell you here, that God's going to show you here, that God's going to do for you here that he can't do anywhere else. There are things that are going to come out of the shepherd. Listen, we know he's the chief shepherd. We have an under shepherd, our pastor. And there's some things that God downloads in him. And just like David had a pouch, right? David was a shepherd. Here we have an under shepherd right here. He's the shepherd of this church. He watches over this flock. And there's some things that God downloads into him that we need. And that when God, he goes and spends his time in his prayer closet, and he goes and hears from God, he hears a word that we need in this house. We can't focus on everybody else's house. We're not going to be comparing ourselves to somebody else's house where they're doing this, where that, it doesn't matter. This is your house. This is your house, and God has a word for you here in your house. And that's why it's not okay for you to be here, there, and everywhere. You be connected to your house. Be faithful to your house. And when your shepherd goes and hears from the chief shepherd, there's going to be some things that he's going to download into him. He's going to put them in his pouch. Then he's going to come on Sunday morning, and he's going to open up that pouch, and he's going to go, here's what you need, and here's what you need, and here's what you need, and here's what you need. God knows what each one of us needs. And you know, you can be hearing the same word, but you're getting what you need, Amanda. And you're getting what you need, Chavello. And you're getting what you need, Ina. And you're getting what you need, Christine. Each one of us, we're hearing the same word, but God knows how to divide that word into so many pieces of every person that's in here, if we're willing to listen. So the shepherd pulls out that word, and he gives it to us. And it's exactly what we need every time. And that's why it's so important that we don't miss our time here. That's why it's so important that we don't miss an appointment with destiny. Every time these doors are open, I'm not even going to say every Sunday, because sometimes it's even other days. Anytime those doors are open, it's an appointment with destiny. And we need to make every effort to be here. And the soccer game, and the baseball game, and the little league, and the cheerleading, and the ice skating, and the whatever else, horseback riding, none of that matters when we're supposed to be here. If we're not connected to the body, we can't function. We have to remain connected. Tell the person next to you, we have to be connected to church. It's huge. It's huge. This is where we come to worship and pray together. This is where we come to to be equipped for the work of the ministry. So many times we think the pastor's supposed to do everything. Not true. He equips us to do the work. I said the Bible says he equips us to do the work. We're to do the work. It's here where our minds get renewed as we hear the word. It's here where our faith gets stirred up. The Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And we hear it over and over and over again. That's how our faith gets stirred up. It's where we get trained to serve God. This is where you get it. It's here where we're discipled, and we're able then in turn to disciple other people. It's here where we have an opportunity to grow up in God and do number two, right? Grow up in God. It's here where we get to hear God's word, and then we have the opportunity to respond to it. Every time that we come here, we should be coming, waiting to hear some marching orders from the Lord, and then be willing, as the army of God, to go out there and do what he said to do. Even when it doesn't feel good to our flesh, even when we don't feel like it, even when we don't understand it, that we just trust God. You want to be a part of the local church. I'm not telling you you have to. I changed how I was going to say it this morning. You want to be part of the local church, part of the body. You want to stay connected. Number four is this. We win when we're united. I said we win when we're united. I want you to know this morning that God birthed Rescue Church. Pastor Paul and I did not put this thing together. We didn't birth Rescue Church. I said God birthed Rescue Church. He gave us the name. He gave us the vision. He did. But it's up to us, the body, to execute it. I said it's up to us, the body, to execute it. God's done his part. We have to do ours. I believe, and I bet you do too, that God wants to do some amazing things. He wants to do some amazing things in us so that he can do some amazing things through us. But the only way we're going to get there is if we're in unity. I said the only way we're going to get there is if we're in unity. Yes, come on, you get excited. It doesn't work any other way. It doesn't work any other way. 1 Corinthians 1:10 says, I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions in the church. Say to the person next to you, no divisions. No divisions. Rather, be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. If we're going to do great things for the Lord in this place, and we said we wanted to, right? We want the church to go to a whole nother level. That means we have to go to a whole nother level. That means we have to do what we're reading in 1 Corinthians 1:10. There can't be divisions in the church. We have to be of one mind. Not my mind, his mind. We have to be united in thought and purpose. In other words, how we think, how we view things. And we're not going to view it from our perspective. We're going to view it from a kingdom perspective. We're ambassadors of heaven, right? Of the kingdom of God. So we're going to use his perspective. Another translation says, let there be real harmony so that there won't be splits in the church. God never meant for church to be doing that. He never meant for church to be doing that. It's such an ugly thing. Divisiveness is such an ugly thing. How many of you know that that's the enemy's scheme? He wants to divide and conquer. I said he wants to divide and conquer. Devil is a liar. Not here. Not in this place. Not in this place. You know why? We're not going to allow that to happen here. The Bible says that the weapons may form, but they will not prosper. In Acts 2:1, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Listen, the presence and the power of God showed up in that place, but it was because they were in one accord. They were united. If we want to see the presence and the power of God show up in this place like never before, then we're going to have to do the same thing. We're going to follow the example that we see in the book of Acts. And we need to be in one accord, of one mind, not our mind, Christ's mind. We need to be united. I want y'all to see this clip. Turn it up so they can hear it. I want you to hear these words.
This was the middle of the Depression.
These boys were the sons of these loggers, the sons of these fishermen.
They were tough. They were used to working in tough conditions.
But every one of them had a measure of humility.
They've had to fight and claw and drag that boat.
And the boat just explodes forward.
There was speculation of whether this was an Olympic team.
There were people screaming down on them. It must have been deafening.
Swing comes when you really have that harmony. Eight hearts beating as one.
And the best teams dream about having it. It's because then they know they can't be touched.
He said, swing happens when you're in unity. And the best teams want it because they know when they have it, they can't be beat. They can't be beat. In rowing, swing is the feeling of being in perfect synchronization with the other rowers in the boat. This is a clip that we just saw from a movie, and such a great movie. I think it's called The Boys in the Boat, if I'm saying that right. I think that's the name of it. And what they were able to do because of unity is amazing. It says that in rowing, it's swing is synchronization with the other rowers in the boat. When a crew is in swing, that means that group that does this rowing in these boats. When a crew is in swing, the boat glides smoothly and steadily between oar pools, and the rowers are moving in unison. The person that steers the boat is the coach. And I think in this sport, if you will, I think it's called a coxswain, C-O-X-W-A-I-N. That's the person that's giving the commands. That's the person that's giving the orders between the rowing of the oars, that's telling them what to do. It tells the team, that coach tells the team what to do the whole time. Swing is a difficult feeling to define. It's a difficult thing to define, but it's achieved when all the rowers are moving in such perfect unison, such perfect unity, that no one's actions is out of sync with the others. It's a feeling of effortless movement, even though all the rowers are using all their muscles at the same time. Swing is achieved through balance, and it can be broken if one rower pulls too hard or if another falls out of rhythm. The opposite of swing is rush, which occurs when the rowers don't row in unity, and that causes the boat to slow down. When it comes to teams, the concept of swing means each person on the team is rowing as if their life depended on it. Rowing is the most selfless sport there is. It requires the complete abandonment of self and total unity. A rowing crew with unity can row faster and easier than they can with pure strength. I'm sharing this because, listen, if we want to do what God's called us to do, church, as a church, Rescue Church, I'm talking to you, it's going to take unity. If we're going to take this place to the next level where God's wanting to take us, it's going to take unity. We can't do it without unity. It's all about the swing. It's all about getting in sync first with God and then with each other. Getting in swing with our coach. Listen, the head coach, the owner of the team, we know who that is, King Jesus. But he's given us a coach. He's given us a coach who's going to be calling out the plays. He's going to be calling out, telling us what to do the whole time. He's going to tell us when we have to go left and right. And we don't have to agree with it. We don't have to like it. We don't have to understand it. But if he's getting the orders from the owner, we need to be okay with it. If he's getting the orders from heaven, we need to be okay with it. And we follow those things, and we're each doing our part. In other words, God is saying, this is what I want to do now, and this is what I want to do next, and go left and go right. It's what happens between us oaring that makes the difference. And as we go, and we do it, doing it in unison. He's calling out those orders. If we rush ahead of God, if we rush to do our own thing, we get out of sync. When we're selfish and we're wanting to do what we want to do instead of what God wants us to do, whether you're in church or wherever you are, even out of church, even if you're an unbeliever and you're watching, you're doing your own thing, it doesn't work. But when we get in sync with the Holy Spirit, when we get in sync with the Word of God, when we're doing what He's telling us to do, it makes life so much easier. It makes things so much smoother. This is a great analogy, and it's a selfless thing when we do that. We can't be selfish and go to the next level with God. Everything that we do is not just for our benefit, it's for the benefit of others. So if what we're doing helps us but it hurts somebody else, we're out of sync. If what we're doing only benefits us, we're out of sync. So we don't want to be selfish. We want to be who God called us to be, and we want to be in sync with Him. Things get easier with Him. God's plan for the church, God's plan for your family, God's plan for your place of business, God's plan for every relationship is that we dwell in unity, that we be united. And the Bible says that when we are in unity, that's where God commands the blessing. That was our opening scripture. He says there, that's the landing strip for my blessing, when you're in unity. Even in your home, be in unity with your spouse. Be in unity with your spouse so that God can command the blessing there. We're to be ambassadors for Christ. We're to bring the mind of Christ into this world. You're to bring the mind of Christ as a married couple. If you're a husband in here, you're to bring the mind of Christ to your wife. You're supposed to bring God's perspective into your home, into your marriage, into your workplace, wherever that you are. You're to bring the mind of Christ into that place. That's why we're here. We're ambassadors for Christ. He says, behold how good and how pleasant it is when we dwell together in unity. When we dwell together in unity. And then verse 3 says, for there the Lord commands the blessing. No matter what we do, no matter what relationship we find ourselves in, no matter where we work, where we go, we have to be in unity. We have to be in unity if we're gonna do what God's called us to do. I believe that God has some amazing things that He wants to do in and through this body. But it's going to take us staying connected to the body, staying in unity, doing these four things that I just shared this morning. We have to do each one of them. We're going to have to stay united. We're going to have to stay committed to church. We're going to have to grow up. And we're going to have to be ambassadors for Christ, doing things His way. No longer coming to church, fighting all the way here, smiling for an hour and a half, fighting all the way back home. It's time to grow up. Don't y'all know that? We know that happens. So don't raise your hand. You're going, I did that this morning. It's time to grow up. It's time to grow up, church. That we're not the same people that we were last year. Next year, we're not the same people that we were this year. That we grow up. That we're not the same people this week than we were last week. That we grow up. God wants us to grow up. He has some things for us to do. But it's going to take cooperation. It's going to take us getting in sync with Him. Amen? And so this morning, that's what I wanted to share with you. I believe that God does want to do some great things in and through us. He can't do them through us until He does it in us. But it's going to take an intimate relationship with Jesus. It's going to take connection to the body of Christ. It's going to take unity. It's going to take us growing up. We can't keep going the way we've been going and expect different results. We got to get out of the high chair. We got to let go of the binky. It's time to grow. Y'all know what a binky is, pacifier. We got to grow. We can't be the Christian that we're always having to be pacified. Got to change your diaper 3 times a day. Still on a bottle. The Lord is saying it's time to grow up. It's time to go the next level. Rescue Church, are y'all ready? Are y'all ready? There's some things that God wants us to do. There's a difference that's to be made. And we're to bring God's perspective. We're to be ambassadors on this earth. We're in this world, but we're not of it. Listen, we have an election coming up. I want y'all to be praying for that election. Start now. Be praying. That's just, in a couple months, the election's happening. Don't be confused and say, oh, I don't know who to vote for. It's not hard when you get the mind of Christ on it. It's not hard. I'm baffled when people say, I don't know who to vote for. Listen, let's see. What does God say about this? What does God say about this? Not what do I think, not what do my friends think, not what is popular, not what did they tell me in college, in the school, nothing. What does God say? It's time that we grow up, church, and that we don't go by our feelings. We don't go by what we think. We don't go by what mama and them think. We go by what God says, and we'll get God results. Amen? Listen, if you're here this morning and you've not completely sold out to Jesus, you've not completely given your life to the Lord, maybe you've never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, maybe you're watching online and you're hearing this word, listen, this isn't just to go to heaven. This is so you can enjoy the life that you have here on this earth while you're on your way to heaven. Then you need to make Jesus the Lord of your life. And that means, and the Savior of your life. That means he's not just going to save you and get you into heaven, but he's going to be your Lord. He's going to be the one that you submit to. He's going to be the one that you're going to let guide you in your life so that you can enjoy this life that you have. If you're in here or you're online and you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, but you say this morning, you know what? I want to surrender my life to him. Would you just lift your hand? Even if you're at home, lift your hand and say, that's me. I would like to give my life to Jesus Christ. I want to surrender my all. Would you just lift your hand up high? I see your hand. Anybody else? Anybody else? I see your hand. Anybody else? I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. Most of all, God sees your hand. Maybe you're in here and you say, you know what? I am a Christian. I gave my life to the Lord. But I'm not living full on for him. I'm not completely surrendered to him. I've not surrendered every area of my life. I'm not staying in the Word. I don't read the Bible. I don't have a prayer life. I pray when I come to church. I pray for my meals, but I don't really pray. I don't really spend time with God. I'm not doing anything to try to grow, but I want a desire to do that. Maybe you don't even have the desire, but you would like the desire to get to know God more, to grow in him, to know what his plan and his purpose is for your life. Would you lift your hand? And I want to pray for you as well. Anybody say, that's me. I want to grow in the things of God. I don't want to stay the same. I don't want to be a baby Christian the rest of my life. I want to be and experience all God's got for me. Okay, so we're going to pray this morning. And for the first group, I want you to repeat after me. If you were receiving Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're online and you're doing it as well, would y'all please repeat this prayer? And I'm going to ask the whole church to say it with us. Let's say it with them. We're going to pray and we're going to ask God to come into our lives and to change us from the inside out. Would you repeat this with me? Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you that you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for my sins. I thank you that 3 days later, you raised him from the dead. I thank you that all my sins are forgiven, past, present, and future. I thank you that you came to give me life, a full life, an abundant life, a good life. I thank you that you have a plan and a purpose for my life. I thank you that I will walk in it. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me from the inside out. Make me more like you. Today I receive you as my Lord and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Give the Lord a hand this morning. I want to pray over you. Lord, I thank you for every person that received you this morning. I thank you that you bring vessels of light, godly friends into their path, Father God. People that they can run this race with, Father God. I thank you that they can get connected to the church that you've called them to. I thank you, Lord, that they seek you, Father God. They seek your face. They, Father, get in your word. They get in your presence. They pray, Father God. They let you talk to them, Father. I thank you, Lord, that you just renew their minds by the power of your word. I thank you, Father God, I thank you that today everything changes for the better in their lives. I thank you, Father. Guard their hearts, guard their minds, keep them, Lord. And now for those of you that said, you know what, I haven't surrendered every part of my life, but I want to Jesus. I'm not living full on. I'm not doing anything to grow, but I want that desire to grow. I'm going to pray over you. Heavenly Father, you know who every person that has a desire, that wants a desire to grow in the things of God, Lord, would you help them? I thank you, Father God, that you give them a hunger and a passion for your presence, a hunger and a passion for your word, a hunger and a passion for your ways, Father God. I thank you, Lord, that you lead them and guide them in every way. I put them in your hands right now. I thank you that they can do all things through you, Christ, who strengthens them. I bless them now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, that Rescue Church is going to the next level, Father God, as we surrender our all to you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Listen, we want to invite you, if you gave your life to the Lord this morning, please go by guest services before you leave. We have something that we want to give you, a next steps package to help you in your walk with the Lord. We love you.